Okay, so one of the big problems that people who study ecology face is that it's really hard to predict which environments are going to be suitable to a species and which are not. This is something that became very clear to me when I did my doctoral work looking at the ecology of Joshua tree in the Mojave Desert of Southern California, Nevada, Arizona, and Utah. That's the other state that Joshua trees are found in. And when I did that, I realized it was really interesting to figure out which environments are suitable to Joshua trees, and when you see differences in the appearance of Joshua tree, whether those different types of Joshua tree are associated with different sets of environments. And so that was a really interesting question to tackle, but it turned out that it would be almost impossible to study that question with an experiment. To do an experiment, you'd want to plant Joshua trees and watch them grow and see how well they did in a particular environment. But the trees live for hundreds of years, and I didn't have that much time to set up my work. And so instead of tackling that problem directly, what I started to notice is that when you went out to the desert, when you had a handle on which environments were suitable to Joshua trees in one location, you could use that as a way to predict which environments are suitable to Joshua trees in another location. Even though I can make predictions by eye, and even though there are statistical methods that would let you make predictions in a similar way, it was still a very hard problem to tackle mathematically. And the reason is that we know that the ecology of any living thing is really complicated. The range of Joshua tree depends on climates, it depends on soils, it depends on other things that eat the trees. In some places it depends on cows that come along and chew on the flowers. It depends on the species of insects that the trees need to pollinate them. So there's all this complexity, and you almost never have a chance to measure how each of those other aspects of the environment interact with the species you're studying, like Joshua tree. What I've been working at NIMBioS is, instead of thinking about this as a problem where you get a handle on every single thing that matters to Joshua tree, let's ask what are the conditions under which we can make predictions. So even if we don't know all the reasons why an environment are suitable to the trees, we can still imagine that there are a set of environments that are suitable, there are a set of environments that Joshua tree can get to, and a set of environments that a naive scientist like me can go and examine in nature to figure out where the trees are present and where they're not. And what I've been able to show mathematically is that under simple conditions at least, if you just think about those sets, you can imagine the probability that a Joshua tree will be present in a set of environments. And it turns out that if you set up your study correctly, that probability, your estimate of the probability that trees are present is also going to serve as an estimate of the probability that an environment is suitable to Joshua tree. And this is something that's useful for Joshua tree, but my hope is that this sort of link between mathematics and biology will be useful for many other species in nature. And the reason is that there are lots of living things that are out in nature, but it's really expensive and difficult to get all the data that you need for any one species. And so if we can use data that's easy to collect, such as where panda bears or polar bears or trees in the rainforest, we can use data on where they're present, which is really easy to gather, to get some idea about which environments are suitable to those organisms right now, and use that to make novel predictions about where they're going to be found in the future. That means that it's going to make our job as ecologists a lot easier than if we had to go to every single species and learn about every interaction each species has with each other.